If you happen to be here today and you've never experienced that process of redemption, this would be a grand day for that to happen. And I hope you'll allow it to happen. If you have been redeemed already, but you still are carrying around heavy chains, it's not because there's a lock on them. Those chains have been unlocked, and God is willing to take them away from you, but sometimes we like to hold on to them. And this would be a great day for you to let go of those chains and experience that kind of freedom that God gives to us. I feel a little bit like Steve Harvey today. Steve Harvey usually says when he comes out to a show, "We got a good one for you today." And I think we got a good one for you today, from some things we're going to share with you about what's been going on, to I trust the message that God has been working in my heart for the last couple of weeks for this day, the music you're going to love. And so thank you so very much for being here. If you are a guest today, if somebody invited you and brought you here, thank you so much for coming. To all of our guests, there's a communication card in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to fill it out, put it in the offering bag as it comes by, and next week through the mail, we'll send you some information about what goes on around New Hope. We promise not to beat on your door or harass you with a phone call, but through the mail give you information that answers a lot of questions about New Hope Community Church. We did not have an 8 o'clock service this morning, so there are some of our 8 o'clock folks in our what would normally be our second service, and you think they're visitors, okay? The 9 o'clock, you just think they're guests, all right? No, they're your family, all right? I tell them they're more spiritual because they get up really early, all right, to come out, except for the guys who only show up when there's a certain football game being played at a particular time. But anyway, it's great to have you guys out today. Let me highlight just a couple of announcements today, because it's our Make a Difference Sunday. We're not going to spend a great deal of time. Hopefully when you get here on Sunday mornings, you pay attention, a little attention to the screen. It's got all the announcements of upcoming things that are going on in greater detail than what we'll go into today. But for those of you who happen to be 55 years or older, it's prime time lunch again a week from Tuesday. So October the 11th, all right, 10-11 at 12 o'clock. Oh, that's kind of cool. 10-11 at 12, okay? And so 10-11 at 12. Can we get 13, 14, and 15 in there to get to 2016? Nah, I can't make that work. But anyway, if you've never been, just show up. If you have been before, you know the routine. It's always a great time. We hope to see you out for that. October the 6th, all month, this is Make a Difference Month, all five Sundays. Today is Make a Difference, Choose Your Life. We're going to talk about that in the sermon. Each week there's a different subject, and I'll go over that kind of in the sermon, but I want to highlight one particular one. October 16th, that's 2 weeks from today, is Make a Difference, Engage with Your Church. And on that day, we're going to be recognizing all of our volunteers. It's going to be our Volunteer Appreciation Day, tied in to Make a Difference Sunday in terms of Engage with Your Church. It's also Pastor Appreciation Day, all right, which I hate talking about. But we were able to get them not to do a big shindig like they normally do. And so somebody will tell you more about that. But that's going to be on October the 16th. Last thing I want to tell you is, many of you know that yesterday we kicked off Make a Difference Month in a really big way, all right? We had a barbecue lunch here yesterday, and the purpose for that lunch was to raise funds for the two families. I'm wearing two, what do we call these? I don't want to say bracelet, wristbands, thank you. Yeah, I didn't want to say I was wearing a bracelet. But anyway, two wristbands. One of them, you all are going to get today, the blue ones, which say Make a Difference on them. And let me read it to you. I thought there was a verse. Oh, okay. It says Make a Difference. I didn't need to take it off. All right? And then the other one is for the two sheriff's employees, Davila and Scanlon, who were both shot at the county jail while they were on duty. And so we did a barbecue yesterday. This was a brainchild of Teddy Miller, one of our elders and very active guys around here. And about 10 days after it happened, he came to me at a breakfast with a couple of other guys and said, "Tim, I want to do something. I think we can do something to make a difference." That got my attention right away. And I said, "What do you got in mind, Teddy?" He said, "Let's do a barbecue. Everybody does tri-tip barbecues. Let's do something different. Let's do a steak barbecue and let's see if we can't raise, you know, $5,000 or $6,000 that we could give to these families." And so we kicked it around that day. Jumped on board and said, "Ted, I think that's a grand idea." We shared it with you all just 2.5 weeks ago, I think, and you all jumped on board. And so let me kind of briefly tell you how yesterday went. We had about 75 to 85 volunteers here by 9 o'clock in the morning. By 10:30, this place was transformed. It was absolutely unbelievable. There were tents set up in the parking lot with the tall tables you see under the pavilion for standing and eating. The pavilion was all set up with tables and decorated for people who wanted to come sit and eat with all the desserts out there. There was a special drive-through lane so the people who wanted to drive through and take their bag with them, it was out there so it wouldn't get congested. We had directors of traffic out on the street. We had people working that booth out there. We had people up here serving and working, and it was absolutely incredible. We were ready by 10:30, and we weren't supposed to start till 12, but people started coming in at 11:30. So we start feeding them at 11:30, and we fed over 1,000 people yesterday. It was incredible. About 825 steak sandwiches were sold. All right, we served about another 250 or 300 hot dogs to those who didn't want steak. Can you imagine choosing between? In Oklahoma, we call them tube steaks, all right? So, but anyway, so about 250 of those were served. Lots of desserts went out of here, all right, for those who stayed and ate. And the goal, original goal, was maybe we might raise, you know, 6,000 or 7,000. Then as it started to grow, momentum started to build, then the goal became, let's sell 1,000 steak sandwiches, let's raise $10,000, all right? Well, we sold about 820 steak sandwiches, and we raised $11,800. So that is the way to start a Make a Difference month on the very first day of the month, man. That is the way to kick it off. Now, we're not through with it. Because remember, we ended up with about 1,100 steaks. And I know there was some confusion because it started out promoting them as ribeyes, and then it switched to New York steak sandwiches, all right? Which is not a bad change, okay? Here's what Harris Ranch provided was the resource for the meat, okay? And they weren't going to have enough fresh ribeyes that we could use for that. So he said, "We're going to have fresh New York, and we'll give them to you at a reduced price, much reduced price." So what had to happen is we got about 480 pounds of ribeyes, and they had to be butterflied. I mean, New York's, thank you. And so because one big New York steak was too big for a sandwich. So butterflied them, laid them out, and that's what you got yesterday, and they just melted in your mouth, man. They just melted in your mouth. So here's the deal. We got about 200 left. So I don't know if you smelled the aroma of a barbecue as you arrived, but the barbecue pit is going. There is a crew of men out there barbecuing right now. So here's the deal. You can buy a $10 bottle of water and get a free steak sandwich. Okay, does that work? Huh? All right. Or you can pay $10 for a steak sandwich and get a free bottle of water or a can of pop out there. All right, soda. It's out there. So, if you want to get an early lunch when service is over, don't leave before service is over. If you want an early lunch after service is over, you can do two things. You can pause out here and you can have some hors d'oeuvres. That's pastries and fresh fruit, all right, unfrozen. And then you can go between the buildings. Just follow your nose. Go between the buildings. You'll see the guys at the barbecue. They're going to have them out there. You can just give them your $10. Take your bag lunch. In the bag is a steak sandwich, a bag of chips, and a cookie, all right? And you can take that and a bottle of pop, and you got your lunch, all right, ready to go. And it is good, good stuff. And all that will just be added to what we raised yesterday. If we sell 200 of them, can you do the math? 200 times 10, that's another 2,000. That'll put us right at $14,000, all right? And as we did yesterday, if you think it's worth more than 10 bucks and you want to give a little extra, it will not be refused, okay? And we don't make change, okay? So, just saying, all right? I think I'm through with all that, all right? Let me talk about a couple of prayer requests and praise items. One of them is the biggest praise item. Carolyn Gilmore has been part of our church family for many, many years. You would recognize Carolyn. She's the lady who often comes in a wheelchair, all right? She would often sit there, or she was in the 8 o'clock service and wore her sunglasses because the lights were very damaging to her. Her health has not been good for quite some time. We've known that. She went under hospice care a couple of months ago. This week took a pretty drastic turn for the worse. I was there the last 3 days. And got a call at 7:46 this morning, and on Resurrection Day, on a Sunday morning, she no longer has the chains of her physical problems holding her down. She knows what it is. As the song says, I can only imagine. And that is where Carolyn is this morning. Her family is very grateful for all your prayers, the support of their small group that has made a huge difference as they've been through this, and each of you who have expressed concern and love towards them during these days. We'll be meeting the first of the week and scheduling the service. We don't know day, timer yet, but we will let you know that as soon as it gets scheduled. So continue to pray for Carolyn's family. Got great news this week from Bernice that her daughter Charlene, they have found a donor match. And it has been scheduled for the end of October, all right? So about 3.5 weeks away from now, they will do the bone marrow transplant. So that is great news. I just found out early this morning that Debbie Young's mom, Clara Bailey, passed away this week. And her memorial service is at her home church, Clovis First Assembly of God, at 11 o'clock on October the 7th. And so they would appreciate your prayers as well. Saw on Facebook, which I don't normally see much on. Hey, your sister's up here. Do you know that, Larry? All right. Carruthers Fair got started yesterday, too, by the way. Oh, Margaret Mims left the Carruthers Fair and came to the event yesterday, all right, to be with us. And so that was terrific. And then I also saw that Gary Best, and I was hoping to see Brandon. I haven't seen him yet this morning, but Gary Best is in the hospital back east. He had an AFib attack, which he has not had in 10 years. And so he's been hospitalized for observation. His blood pressure is still low, and hopefully we'll get an update later today, but if you'd remember him. So those are things I wanted to share with you. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings. Gentlemen, would you come, please? Following the ushers is going to be another group of guys, and they're going to be handing out wristband to everybody. We'd love for you to wear them for the month, all right? Make a difference when people ask you. Tell them what we're talking about, make a difference at New Hope Church, and you want your life to make a difference. And the one who's made the biggest difference in your life has been Jesus Christ. And so you have an opportunity to share what all this means. So would you join with me as we pray? And I'm going to point to four men after the ushers get down a few rows. And if you would help with the wristbands, that would be terrific. Yes. Yes, Tammy, you may say something. If you would stand and use your outside voice like you're talking to your husband. Yeah. Yeah. Our high school kids, boy, they came through. They really did. They did a great job. Attaboy, Chris. Yeah, there are some young men and some young ladies in a high school group that do know how to work. And that was terrific to have them. They were engaged the entire day. So thank you, thank you. Thanks for doing that, Tammy. Let's pray. Father, I love you. Thank you for the opportunity to share in worship and celebration of your life in us. Thank you for the opportunity to share this day with family and friends. Lord, you know what the needs are in each of our lives, and we know about some of them publicly. We know about Carolyn's family, and so we pray for your strength and comfort to be evident in them. There was the sadness of her absence from their presence this morning as I met with them. But there was also great joy knowing that their mom was where she desired to be and knowing that her mom had the hope of heaven. And so we thank you for the difference that makes in our lives. Lord, we trust you with the needs of Gary Best, who's a long ways from us, but Father, he's never far from you because you live in him. And though his physical heart may be having a struggle, we know that his spiritual heart is well and healthy. And so we trust you with his needs today. Lord, for Charlene, we are so grateful for the good news they received this week, and we commit her needs to you. Lord, it's great to see Donna with us today, and she's feeling stronger and better, and so we thank you for that strength, and we just continue to lift her needs up to you. Father, for what transpired here yesterday and the way in which lives were touched by this act of generosity, love, compassion, it's making a difference. And so we say thank you. Father, to have retired sheriff officers come up with tears running down their face simply to say thank you for caring, that made a difference for me yesterday. And so, Lord, we continue to pray for Davila and Scanlon. We're so grateful that Mrs. Davila is doing so well and improving. We continue to trust you for Officer Scanlon's needs. He's still in ICU. He's had a bad week this week. And we just lift him up to you today and the needs of his family. Lord, for what you want to do in our midst today, may you find minds and hearts that are willing to listen to you and then move to the next step, and that is trust you, be submissive to you. And thank you for the privilege of giving, sharing today. We do so in the awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. I forgot to give greetings, and I apologize to, there's an overflow crowd, a little bit of folks over in the other building, all right, where the 8 o'clock service is. So, greetings to those of you who are over in the other building. Thank you for doing that, and I apologize for the fly-infested circumstances that you were in. A lot of people ate in there yesterday, and the smoke from the barbecue sort of flowed through there, and the flies followed the smoke, and there were hundreds of flies in there when I went in this morning. We tried to chase many of them out, all right, and we've turned some high school kids loose in there, and that'll probably run the rest of them out, but thank you for your willingness to go over and leave room in here for folks who are here. It has been literally an amazing week. Got home late Wednesday evening from our 10-day trip that four of us guys went on. We saw some absolutely beautiful portions of God's creation. We got to see all the fall colors changing through northeastern California and the whole west coast of Idaho. And the Henrys send their greetings back to their friends and family from here at New Hope. I had a chance to visit with Ron for about a half an hour as we worked our way through Coeur d'Alene. He doesn't miss us. They are loving it up there. They have run into a lot of transplants from Fresno and Clovis who've retired up to there. He's fishing 3 or 4 days a week. They have found a church family they have connected to. He actually ran into and met a high school friend of mine who's retired and moved up there. Some of you work with Clovis Unified. We'll remember Joe Bjerke. All right, he was the transportation director, and he and his wife moved up there about 2 years ago. And so they're having a grand time and wanted me to give greetings to you all. We did find grizzly bear. We saw three of them. They were beautiful. Maybe we'll give you pictures one of these days. But maybe the biggest thing we saw was a big, gigantic moose. He was just mammoth. And I don't want to go into too much explanation. But most of do you all know what the rut is? It's breeding season. Some of you said yeah. So he was pretty aggressive, and he had one thought in mind, and he was pursuing that. So we meant nothing to him as he walked about as close as this front row is to us. All right. That was not our intent, but sort of worked out that way. But it was great. Got home, and of course, we knew we had this event yesterday, and so gearing up for that. But in the meantime, I also had the privilege of going. Do all of you remember HOW? The HOW organization? Okay, all right, now that I say, okay, helping one woman, all right, the organization that blessed Jan Patton from our church with that very special evening. Well, they had a fundraising event on Friday night, and I had agreed to play auctioneer for them. And so got to go to that event on Friday night, and what a blessing that was. And though they are not overtly faith-based, they are faith-based, and three of the recipients who shared talked about Christ and faith and the encouragement that the Howe organization had been to them, and how these are popping up all over the state of California, and next week a new chapter is popping up in Nevada. And so that was really just a very, very delightful evening. And so it has been a really, really good week. I thought maybe I ought to start off today with a little bit of review, because I realized there are several of you who are here today that were not around in 2010 when we did our very first Make a Difference weekend. And so I thought maybe I ought to take just a moment or two and share just a little bit of history. Why this day, and why this thrust and all this hoopla over three words: making a difference. Well, it got started in January of 2010 as I watched my mother live out her last 41 days of life with us. I observed that as the physical quality of her life diminished, her spiritual life seemed to be more vibrant than ever. As she had, in that process of 41 days, both of her lungs collapse one Sunday after another, I watched the vitality of her spiritual life shine greater than I had ever seen in her entire life. You see, my mom wanted her last days to count. She wanted her last days to make a difference. And for a few people, I know she did make the difference. God used Mom to rescue a marriage of a nurse and her husband. This nurse had found out my mother was a pastor's wife, and late one night when all of us as family had left, she snuck into my mother's room and she asked for advice and she asked for prayer. She was determined that when she went home that night, she was telling her husband their marriage was over. And instead, she went home that night and told her husband, "I want a fresh start." And that man came to my mother's hospital room 2 days later with tears down his face, thanking Mom for the direction that he had given to his wife, that he had been praying for a turnaround in their marriage. Mom had a bad night late one night, again, when none of us were there. She found herself on the floor in a mess. She couldn't get up. The nurse came in and found her, and the nurse by herself knew she couldn't get her up. But Mom was a little frightened at that moment. And this nurse got down on the floor and laid with Mom until somebody else could come in and assist them. And the next evening, Mom asked for someone to come into her room, an administrator. And Mom dictated a letter about this nurse. None of us knew that. 2 weeks after Mom's funeral, 2 weeks after Mom's memorial service, I get a phone call from a friend of mine who was in a pretty high position at St. Agnes in the nursing program. And she said, "Tim, I don't know that you want to, but I think you probably would. There is a special service coming up in about 2 weeks. It's called the Daffodil Award. It's one of the highest awards that nurses in our hospital get. And the nurse who's receiving it at St. Agnes this time is because of a letter your mother wrote." And I said, "Didn't know my mom wrote a letter." And, "Well, she dictated it to one of our administrators, and boy, did it make an impact." And so our family went, and we attended that little award ceremony there. You see, Mom's life in the last 41 days, she barely had it sometimes breath to breathe. She made a difference, and that reached into my heart. And then in June of that same year, I was afforded the privilege of sharing in a memorial service for John Rodriguez. He was the father of Beth, who had gone to school with my sons. He was the husband to Terry that we had met over the years. And what I discovered was that John Rodriguez had a life theme.
It came out again and again in his memorial services. One after another, people stood to pay tribute to him. And every single one of them, and probably 25 people, stood to give a 30-second comment about what John meant to them. And every single person who stood, including his children, said, John Rodriguez never left their presence without uttering these words, go make a difference. His kids said, when Dad let us off at elementary school, his words were, make a difference on the playground. When we got to high school, make a difference in your classroom. To the kids that he coached in soccer, they stood up, now grown men, and they, every one of them said the same thing, make a difference. Those two events resonated in my spirit in 2010, and God would not stop whispering those words in my head again and again, saying something like, choose to let me work through you. As you make a difference in somebody else's life, I then can have the opportunity to make the difference in their life. Do you get the drift of that? If you and I have a heart to make a difference in somebody's life, that opens the door for God to make the difference in their life. We do something momentary that touches their heart. It opens them up for the grace of God to do something eternal in them. I understood God to say to me in 2010, Tim, you need to preach it, you need to live it, you need to experience it. So I started looking for opportunities. A sermon series began to take shape that I preached back then. A sense of clarity about scheduling a day of emphasis was developed. I talked to a few others, some other couples, all right, from various age groups in our church, from the 20s and the 30s and the 40s and the 50s and I wasn't in my 60s then, but the folks who were older, all right? And I got them together and I said, here's what God seems to be doing in my life. Would you like to come on board and help us figure out how to do this day? And every one of them said yes. And I don't have time to talk about every one of them, but I'm going to point out one particular one. Teddy and Christy Miller, would you stand, please? Teddy. Oh, they went to overflow. Okay. Teddy and Christy, would you stand, please? Teddy, get away from the barbecue, all right? But they had been coming to church since the day I married them, which, by the way, their anniversary was last week. If you saw their pictures posted on Facebook. You can tell how often I get on Facebook. And they had been coming to church for years. They always sat right back there behind the steels on that row, all right? Every Sunday, they were always there, but never engaged. And when we asked them to be a part of that committee, they said yes. And since that moment, they have become high school group leaders in the high school program. Teddy has become an elder at the church, and it was Teddy Miller who felt the impression of God to do a barbecue to help two people that none of us even know so that we can make a difference in their lives. That first make a difference has indeed made a difference around our church. I read a statistic that said 73% of the people who have a relationship with Jesus Christ do so because a friend or relative invited them to church. That's why we were asking you this month, invite friends and family to come to church with you. It's where it can make a difference. Driving home one evening, I was channel surfing the radio and I paused at K-Love. And I heard this female DJ say, I want you to all get mad this week. I thought, this is a Christian radio station. What do you want people to get mad this week over? So I kept listening, and I discovered that mad means make a difference. I said, wow, I'm thinking about this. We're planning this. Then I came home a day early from a trip I had been on. This is the week preceding that first Mad Sunday. And I came home early and I went by Majesty Christian Bookstore, and sitting there on the shelf was a brand new book written by Max Licato entitled, Outlive Your Life. You were made to make a difference. I said, okay, God, I think I got the picture. This is your plan for us here. Oh, and did I mention that John Rodriguez, the guy whose funeral I did, he was a roommate of Max Licato's in Bible college. God has this incredible, crazy sense of humor. Do you see why I believe that this idea, this what I believe really is a biblical truth and principle called let's make a difference, That this is not just some crazy notion of a pastor that's trying to make his church bigger. Because bigger churches don't make a difference. Growing faith makes a difference. Demands of a pastor will not make a difference in the world, but the dynamics of Christ alive and cut loose in us, that does. Schemes and tricks do not make a difference, but listening and obeying the whispers of God in your soul does. Thank God that Teddy Miller listened to the whisper of God in his heart to make a difference yesterday. He's going to tell me after this service is over, Tim, don't ever talk about me so much in a sermon again. He really loved doing the interviews on television yesterday. Inviting people to check out our religion is a waste of time, but inviting people to come check out Jesus Christ will make all the difference in their life. I want you to listen to a brief clip of somebody that might catch some of you by surprise. His name is Bono. All right? So drop the lights and maybe the first row or two of those things, and let's watch this clip.
I look to the scriptures for poetic truth, as well as the sort of historical stuff I'm interested in. And of course, there was a historical Jesus.
No, I'm talking about God.
Oh, right. The person of Christ is my way to understand God.
Do you pray?
Yes.
To whom or what do you pray?
To Christ.
What way? To Christ.
Yeah.
And what do you pray for?
I pray to get to know the will of God, because then the prayers have more chance of coming true. I mean, that's the thing about prayer, isn't it? I mean, we don't do it in a very lofty way in our family. There's just a bunch of us on the bed, usually. We have a very big bed in our house. And all our... We've prayed with all our kids. We read the scriptures, we pray. It's not even regular. Sometimes if we go to church on a Sunday, we go when the church has ended and we'll just go in on our own as a family.
For peace and quiet.
For peace and quiet. And we'll pray, usually about people that we know who are struggling with something, illness or whatever.
So then, what or who was Jesus as far as you're concerned?
I think it's a defining question for a Christian, is who was Christ. And I don't think you're let off easily by saying a great thinker or a great philosopher because actually he went round saying he was the Messiah. That's why he was crucified. He was crucified because he said he was the Son of God. So he either, in my view, was the Son of God or he was
not.
No, nuts.
Nuts, yes.
Forget
yes.
Rock and roll messianic complexes. This is like, I mean, Charlie Manson type delirium. And I find it hard to accept that all the millions and millions of lives, half the earth for 2,000 years, have been touched, have felt their lives touched and inspired by some nutter. I don't believe it.
Therefore it follows that you believe he was divine.
Yes.
And therefore it follows that you believe that he rose physically from the dead.
Yes, yeah, I have no problem with miracles. I'm living around them. I am one.
So when you pray then, you pray to Jesus.
Yes.
The risen Jesus.
Yes.
And you believe that he made promises which will come true.
Yes. I do.
We're going to look at make a difference, ignite your community. And I believe those of you who were here last week, you saw the Palau intro video, if I'm not mistaken. You're going to see that again that day. We are going to be taking an offering, all right, for the Least Palau conference that's coming called Fresno City Fest in April, all right, on April Fool's Day of next year. We're going to let the fools for Christ share their faith with the entire community, the city, the valley. And so we're going to give you a chance to bring an offering that day. As a church family, we've already made one contribution, but now as individuals, I want you to have some skin in the game for next April. And I want you to have skin in the game in two ways. Number one, Get some money out and put it in an offering plate, all right? Because this is an evangelistic outreach within the community of Fresno, much like Billy Graham's crusade that have come here. Luis Palau is phenomenal. The work that's being done for this, I fully 100% support. So I want you to put some skin in the game. And I want you to do it not only financially, but then those cards that we passed out, we're going to pass them out again. I want you to put down three or four or five names, friends or family members. Remember, 73% of the people who come to know Jesus Christ is because somebody invited them to church. All right, well, you still got 27% out there. So don't invite them to church. Invite them to the Fresno City Fest event. All right? And we're going to find out more about that on that particular day. And then week five, another big wrap up to this whole thing. Make a difference. Let's expand our world. Okay, let's look beyond ourselves and just what we can see, and let's see how big a world God has for us. Listen to the words of this taxi cab driver. This is a review from the very first Make a Difference sermon. After that, nothing else is review, but it's a great way to start this. This is a true story of a taxi cab driver. He said, "Because I drive the night shift, my cab often becomes a moving confessional. Passengers climb in, sit behind me in total anonymity, and they tell me about their lives. I encounter people whose lives amaze me, ennoble me, make me laugh, and sometimes I cry. But none touched me more than a woman I picked up late one August night. Responding to a call from a small brick fourplex in a quiet part of town, I assumed I was being sent to pick up some partiers or someone who had just had a fight with a lover or a worker heading to an early shift at some factory in the industrial part of town. When I arrived at 2:30 a.m., the building was dark except for a single light on a ground floor window. Under these circumstances, many drivers would just honk once or twice and then drive away. But I had seen too many impoverished people who depend on taxis as their only means of transportation. Unless the situation smelled of danger, I always went to the door. This passenger might be somebody who needs my assistance, I reasoned to myself, so I walked to the door and I knocked. Just a minute, said a frail, elderly voice. After a very long pause, the door opened and a small woman in her 80s stood before me. She was wearing a print dress and a pillbox hat with a veil pinned on it like somebody out of a 1940s movie. The apartment looked as if no one had lived in it for years. All the furniture was covered with sheets. There were no clocks on the wall, knickknacks, or utensils on the counter. In the corner was a cardboard box with photos and glassware. Would you carry my bag to the car?" she asked. I took the bag and then I turned to assist her, and she took my arm and we walked slowly towards the curb. She kept thanking me for my kindness. It's nothing, I told her. It's nothing. I just try to treat my passengers the way I would want my mother to be treated. "Oh, you're such a good boy," she said. When we got in the cab, she gave me an address. And then she asked, "Could you drive through downtown? It's not the shortest way," I told her quickly. I don't mind," she said. I'm in no hurry. I'm on my way to a hospice home." I looked in the rearview mirror. Her eyes were glistening. I don't have any family left. And the doctors say I don't have very long." I quietly reached over and I shut off the meter. "What route would you like me to take?" I asked. For the next 2 hours, we drove through the city. She showed me the building where she had once worked as an elevator operator. We drove through the neighborhood where she and her husband had lived when they were newlyweds. She pulled me up in front of a furniture warehouse that had once been a ballroom where she had gone dancing as a girl. Sometimes she would ask me to slow in front of a particular building or a corner, and she would sit staring in the darkness, saying nothing. As the first hint of the sun was coming up over the horizon, suddenly she said, I'm tired. Let's go now." We drove in silence to the address she had given me. Two orderlies came out to the cab as soon as we pulled up. They were solicitous and intent, watching her every move. They must have been expecting her. I opened up the trunk of my cab. I took out the small suitcase and carried it to the door. The woman was already seated in the wheelchair. How much do I owe you, sir?" She reached for her purse. "Nothing," I said. "Nothing. You have to make a living," she answered. "There are other passengers," I responded. Almost without thinking, I bent and I gave her a hug. She held on to me tightly, And then she whispered, "You gave an old woman a few moments of joy. Thank you." I squeezed her hand and I walked in the dim morning light. Behind me, a door shut, and it was the sound of a closing of a life. I couldn't pick up any more passengers on that shift. I just drove aimlessly, lost in my thoughts. For the rest of the day, I could hardly talk. What if that woman had gotten an angry driver? Or one who was impatient to end a shift? What if I had refused to take the run or had honked once and driven away? This cabbie confessed, "I don't think I've done anything more important in my life." We are conditioned to think that our lives revolve around great moments, but great moments will often catch us unaware. They are beautifully wrapped in what others might consider a small moment. The taxi cab driver did not settle for boredom that evening. He chose an adventure. He turned a taxi ride into a defining moment. He made a difference in that woman's life, which made a difference in him for the rest of his life. Mark Batterson, a pastor and an author, once wrote a magazine article entitled, "Get a Life." It was an exhortation to other pastors. His theory was, if your sermons are boring, it's probably because your life is boring. Pastors must have a life outside of the four walls of the church so that we actually have something to say that people can identify with. Mark said in that article, if you want to preach more interesting sermons, live more adventurous lives. That's why I go looking for grizzly bears every couple of years. And that exhortation isn't just for preachers, ladies and gentlemen. It doesn't matter who you are or what you do. Our lives are sermons. You preach a message every single day that you live. To take it a step further, our life is a very unique translation of the Scriptures. I grew up on the KJV, which means what? King James Version. I preach from the NIV, which means what? New International Version. There's some other versions out there like the NASB, New American Standard Bible. But you're standing here looking today at the TMR Version. That's the Timothy McLean Rolen Version of the Scriptures. All right? You get a chance to see Tim Keppler Version of the Bible every time he sings and he speaks. You see, the Apostle Paul said, in 2 Corinthians 3:3, "You show that you are a letter from Christ, the result of our ministry, written not with ink, but written by the Spirit, capital S, of the living God, not written on tablets of stone or parchments of paper, but written on the tablets of the human heart." You see, you might be the only Bible that some of your friends or family members will ever get a chance to read. So here's the question. Are we a good translation? Are we a good translation in the lives of those who are reading our life? Jesus said in John 10, verse 10, "I come that they may have life and they might have it more abundantly." Do other people look at your life and want what you have? Or do they want no part of your religion? The abundant life that Jesus offers is two-dimensional. It is quantitative and it is qualitative. By quantitative, I mean it is eternal life. And the eternal life is the definition of happily ever after. We get to go. Carolyn is happily ever after this morning, folks. That's the way that story, that's not a fairy tale. That's the way the truth of that story ends. But in the meantime, before the quantitative kicks in for us, we also have another dimension to this life with Christ. It is qualitative. That's the adventurous life that God comes to live in and through us. A life, I promise you, that is anything but boring. That's God's original intent when He created humankind in the beginning. God told His image bearers to work out the garden, have dominion over creation. That was God's invitation and directive to Adam and Eve. Explore, discover, and enjoy all that I have given to you. The greatest adventures don't have to be halfway around the world. They are often right across the street or down a hallway or sitting in the seat right next to you. You don't have to go looking for adventure. I love one of the songs we sang today. It matches right here beautifully. If we follow Jesus, adventure comes looking for us. Jesus didn't carry a cross to Calvary so that you and I could live a halfway life. He died so that we could come alive in the truest and fullest sense of the word. He rose from the dead, not primarily to take us to heaven, though that's part of the package, but Jesus rose from the dead so he could return and live within us. He died for us so he could live in us. Do you think the life of Jesus was boring? If you do, you have not read the Gospels very closely. Go read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John and tell me that was a boring life to live. So what I'm going to challenge you with today is this. Accept the challenge. Choose the adventure of a life that trusts and follows Christ. And for those of you who are already Christians and you're here today, here is my challenge to you. Stop playing it safe. Stop playing it safe. Be willing to get engaged in the adventure that God has for us. And it's filled with all kinds of adventures. Who would have known that driving a cab to pick up an old woman at 2:30 in the morning could be an incredible adventure? It wouldn't have been for most folks. But if you and I have eyes to see and ears to hear the whispers of God in our life, then when you hear something on the news about a shooting that takes place at a jail, all of a sudden you get engaged in a barbecue that feeds over 1,000 people and raises $11,000. Those kind of things happen if we're in for the adventure. We were meant for more than a safe ride when God placed us here. Richard Foth, pastor, college president, father, and grandfather said, late in his life, he said, I've discovered a few things that matter. One, loving in hard times is the best kind of loving. Number two, at the end of the day, most folks do exactly what they want to. So we need to focus on the want to's. Number three, life is a wilderness. But when we invite Jesus Christ to be our guide, all bets are off. 50 people over the age of 95 were asked one question. If you had your life to live over again, did you hear how old I said these people were? They were 95. There's not very many of you in here that are that old. Close. They were asked one question. If you had to live your life over again, what would you do differently? And that's a perfect question, I think, to ask a group of people with 5,000 years of cumulative life experience. Three answers emerged as a consensus. Number one, if we could do it over again, we would risk more. Number two, we would reflect more. Number three, we would do more things that live on after we die. Reflect on those three things. Risk, reflect, and invest in something that lives beyond you. Let me tell you what this means to me as I wrap this up. I don't want to feel pressure in life, but rather I want to sense passion because of life. I don't want to live stressed out by the problems that we face every day, but rather I want to be surprised by the solution that God brings. I don't want to see trash in people's mistakes, but rather I want to discover the treasures that will be found in their redemption. I don't want to dwell on problems, but I want to discover opportunities. I don't want to invite, listen to this one, I don't want to invite Jesus to go with me where I go. I want to accept His invitation to go where He leads me. And guys, ultimately He leads me to heaven. But He would love to take us on an adventure between now and then. We are hardwired for an adventure that's unique as you are. You may think that you are not an adventurer. You may never stand on the deck of an ocean liner and feel the salt spray on your face. You may never face down the chasm of the Grand Canyon on a rim hike. But we are all wired for the ultimate adventure of following Jesus. When Jesus summoned the disciples to follow Him, the average person in that century never traveled more than a 30-mile radius from their birthplace. That's about like from here to Kingsburg. That's as far as they ever went their entire life, and they thought that was around the world. And wow, did things change. These men were planning on living their entire lives fishing the Sea of Galilee, but Jesus sent them to the uttermost parts of the earth. He took them adventuring with Him. They hiked to the Mount of Transfiguration. They sailed the Sea of Galilee. They went on long camping trips. And along the way, they witnessed some remarkable miracles on a regular basis. And they did more than witness them. Have you ever gotten this sense of the miracles that Jesus did with the disciples? That miraculous catch of fish that Jesus had with His disciples, those disciples got to fillet those fish and eat them. They toasted the water that Jesus turned to wine, and they drank it to the dregs. Those disciples got to hug Lazarus while he still had his stinking grave clothes on. They gathered 12 baskets full of leftovers from a boy's little bag lunch after feeding thousands. You know what? Maybe that's what happened to those New York steaks as they multiplied in the refrigerator yesterday, so that we had more left for today. You see, you can't put a price tag on those kind of experiences, but once you've had them, they define us forever. The very nature of the gospel is Jesus inviting the disciples on an adventure to do what they had never done and go where they'd never been. Never a dull moment with Jesus. You cannot follow Jesus and be bored at the same time. Soren Kierkegaard, the 19th century Danish theologian, went so far to say that boredom is the root of all evil. Boredom isn't just boring. I think it's downright wrong. This I will close. Tennessee Williams, the storyteller, tells of someone who forgot. And this is my challenge to us today. Let's not forget the adventure that God has called us to. It's the story of Jacob Brodsky, a shy Russian Jew whose father owned a bookstore. The older Brodsky wanted his son to go to college. The boy, on the other hand, desired to do nothing more than marry Lila, his childhood sweetheart. She was a French girl who was very ambitious and was as outgoing as he was laid back. A couple of months after young Brodsky went to college, his father fell ill and died, and the son returned home, buried his father, and he married Lila. The couple then moved into the apartment above the bookstore, and Brodsky took over its management. The life of books fit him perfectly, but it cramped her personality. She wanted more adventure, and she found it, she thought, when she met an agent who praised her beautiful singing voice, enticed her to tour Europe with his vaudeville company. Brodsky was devastated. At their parting, he reached into his pocket and he handed her the key to the front door of the bookstore. And he said, "You'd better keep this, because someday you'll want it. Your love is not that much less than mine that you cannot get away from it. You will come back sometime, and I will be waiting." She kissed him and left. To escape the pain he felt, Brodsky withdrew into his bookstore, and he took to reading as somebody else might have taken to drink. He spoke little, he worked little, and he could most times be found at the large desk near the rear of his shop, immersed in his books, while he waited for his love to return. Nearly 15 years after they parted at Christmas time, she did return. But when Brodsky rose from the reading desk, he took the love of his life as an ordinary customer. "Do you want a book?" He didn't recognize her, and that startled her, but she gained possession of herself, and she said, "I want a book, but I have forgotten the name." And then she told him a story of childhood sweethearts, a story of newly married couple who lived in an apartment above a bookstore, a story of a young, ambitious wife who left to seek a career, who enjoyed great success, but could never relinquish the key her husband gave her. She told him the story. She thought it would bring him to himself, but his face showed no recognition. Gradually, she realized that he had lost touch with his heart's desire, that he no longer knew the purpose of his waiting and grieving, and now all he remembered was the waiting and the grieving itself. "You remember it. You remember it. You must. It's the story of Lila and Jacob." After a long pause, he said, there's something familiar about that story. I think I read it somewhere. I think it's something by Tolstoy." Dropping the key, she fled the shop. And Brodsky returned to his desk, to his reading, to his boredom, unaware that the love he waited for had come and gone. Tennessee Williams wrote that in 1931, and it's entitled Something by Tolstoy. And it reminds us how easy it is to miss the love of God and to miss sharing the love of God. Be very careful how you live, Ephesians tells us, not as unwise, but as wise. Making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Do not miss the opportunity of a lifetime because you're playing it safe. I don't know where you are in your spiritual walk with God, but if you don't know Jesus Christ, why don't you let Him make a difference in your life right now? Why postpone 1 second longer, 1 moment longer, knowing that, one, you have a home in heaven, but number two, between now and then, you have a qualitative life of adventure of Jesus living in you? Would you bow your heads with me right now, all of you? Just bow your heads with me. If you've never, ever accepted Jesus Christ in your life, you were maybe brought today by a friend or a relative, or you came to the barbecue yesterday and showed up again. It's not an accident that you're here. It's an adventure that you're here. And why don't you invite Christ in your life? No special formula, no magic prayer, but something like this. Use your own words, but something like this. Lord Jesus, I've ignored you. I've ran from you. I've not trusted you. I've not liked other Christians. But something brought me here today, and I need to make a decision. I need to choose life, not death. I need to choose adventure, not boredom. I need to choose Jesus, not myself. Thank you for directing your Son to die on the cross for the penalty of my sin and rebellion. Thank you that in spite of that, you love me anyway, and you brought me here so I could have a relationship with you. And God, I give my life to you right now. With everyone's head still bowed, if you were praying that prayer while I was praying it, I'm not going to come to you, not going to embarrass you in any way, may not even know your name, but if you prayed that prayer just now, just quietly and quickly put your hand up and back down so throughout the day I can give thanks to the Lord for what happened today. All right? Amen. Someone else? Yeah, God brought me here today. Amen. Okay. Anyone else? Lord Jesus, I've invited you to come live within my life. For the vast majority of you, I know you. You're Christians. You love God. But maybe you've discovered today you've been playing it safe too long. Maybe you think because you've become a senior citizen, you have to play it safe. No, you don't. I'm not recommending you go hiking the Grand Canyon. But I'm telling you that as my mother in a hospital bed chose adventure, you can choose adventure at whatever stage of life you're in if you're willing to risk. Maybe you need to pray a prayer something like this. Lord Jesus, I'm so grateful for you forgiving me of my sin and living in my life. I'm grateful that I know when I keep that same appointment that Carolyn Gilmore has kept today that I'm going to heaven. But God, between now and then, I want my life to be useful for you. I want my life to have an impact on my relatives, my neighbors, my friends. I'm willing to say something that I might not know answers to, like, hey, I believe in God, do you? And they may give you an answer you don't, but you're willing to take the risk in kindness and in love. You're willing to take a risk. Lord Jesus, I'm ready to do that today. I'm ready to stop playing it safe but have more adventure in my life. And if you prayed something like that over these last couple of moments, would you just raise your hand and put it right back down? God, I'm ready to be more risky than I've ever been before. Amen. Father, thank you. Thank you for lighting a fire within us. Thank you for pushing us a bit to get out of our comfort zone and to realize that wherever we are with you ought to be our comfort zone because you are more than sufficient for every need we face. Thank you. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen and amen.